are explained on national television by Prime Minister Trudeau.
Let me turn now to the broader implications of the threat represented by the FLQ and similar organizations. If a democratic society is to continue to exist, it must be able to root out the cancer of an armed revolutionary movement that is bent on destroying the very basis of our freedoms. For that reason, the government, following an analysis of the facts, including the requests of the government of Quebec and of the city of Montreal for urgent action, decided to proclaim the War Measures Act. It did so at 4 a.m. this morning in order to permit the full weight of government to be brought quickly to bear on all those persons advocating or practicing violence as a means of achieving political ends. At the moment, the FLQ is holding hostage two men in the Montreal area, one a British diplomat, the other a Quebec cabinet minister. They are threatened with murder. Should the governments give in to this crude blackmail, we would be facing the breakdown of the legal system and its replacement by the law of the jungle. The government's decision to prevent this from happening is not taken just to defend an important principle. It is taken to protect the lives of Canadians from dangers of the sort I have mentioned. Freedom and personal security are safeguarded by laws. Those laws must be respected in order to be effective. The criminal law, as it stands, is simply not adequate to deal with systematic terrorism. The police have therefore been given certain extraordinary powers necessary for the effective detection and elimination of conspiratorial organizations which advocate the use of violence. These organizations and membership in them have been declared illegal. The powers include the right to search and arrest without warrant, to detain suspected persons without the necessity of laying specific charges immediately, and to detain persons without bail. These are strong powers, and I find them as distasteful as I am sure you do.
Let me say at the outset that I am as repelled by the activities of these terrorists as any other Canadian. In a society such as ours, terrorism is an ugly and unnecessary cancer that we must do everything to eliminate. Everything, that is, except change the very nature of our free society that we are trying, in fact, to protect. In the process of defending freedom, we must not destroy it. In the process of protecting democracy, we must reduce to a necessary minimum any departure from democratic procedures. I want to make it clear that action is necessary and that the government must have the necessary power to deal with this small group of ruthless men.
The information we do have showed a situation of criminal acts and criminal conspiracy in Quebec, but there is no information that there was unintended or apprehended or planned insurrection, which alone could justify invoking the War Measures Act.
The next day, Saturday, October the 17th, with over 300 people already in prison, organized public reaction gets underway in Quebec. The civil rights groups defy the War Measures Act and meet at the University of Montreal. They condemn the government's action. And all over Quebec, students meet to protest and to organize walkouts. The University of Quebec closes down, followed by most of the other universities in the province. While some French Canadians hide from the police, the government suggests that a number of prominent English Canadians leave Quebec for their own safety. But most people nervously lie low at home and follow the events as best they can on radio and television. That afternoon, Saturday, October the 17th, the government has agreed to fly the kidnappers to Cuba should they give themselves up. An aeroplane waits on the tarmac at Dorval. But it is too late. That evening, the airways are filled with stories of death.
A few moments ago, we received confirmation that the bodies of Mr. Laporte and Mr. Cross have been discovered. The newsroom of Telemedia is trying to obtain more information, which will be passed on to you in a few minutes.
Is there any mention of Cross? It's not confirmed. Okay. Network music. We should like to remind listeners once again that 11:10 p.m. exactly, close to St. Hubert Airport, that the car which was used 1 week ago to kidnap Pierre Laporte in front of his home on Robitaille Street at St. Lambert was formally identified. The Quebec police force is on its way to Rawdon, where the body of Mr. James Richard Cross is said to have been discovered. He is the second hostage who was kidnapped a little over 2 weeks ago. Mr. Cross is the senior British trade commissioner. Several Montreal radio stations have already announced the death of Mr. Cross, but no official police confirmation has been received yet. At exactly 12:25, or rather at 0:25, or 25 minutes after midnight, the trunk of the car was finally opened and the body of Mr. Laporte was discovered, covered in blood. CKAC, Telemedia, first with the news. We'll be back in a few moments. Norman Maltese, Telemedia, Montreal.
Laporte's body is in this car, found by two journalists, one of whom was Claude Lachance.
And then we called the police, who took about half an hour to get here.
Did you expect to discover the body?
Yes. Yes, because knowing the FLQ, they never lied in their communiques. Finding the car with the license number, which they had indicated, it was 90% sure that there was something in it, and it had to be the body of Laporte. We didn't expect to find any dynamite. I was about 100 feet from the car, 75 feet from the car, because the police wouldn't let us come near, especially as there could have been dynamite. We didn't know what was in the trunk. All the police told us was that there was something very heavy in the trunk of the car. And they opened it, and the policeman who opened the trunk, he was from the bomb disposal unit. And they opened the trunk, and they said that there was indeed a man in the trunk. We tried to get closer, but the police wouldn't let us. All we could see was some white clothes with bloodstains on them. And then, a few minutes later, the men from the identification squad arrived, and they removed the clothes, and we recognized the body of Laporte. I saw him because when he was taken out of the trunk, I caught a glimpse of his body very, very briefly. He was wearing a sweater, a small sweater, pushed to here. His wrists were wrapped in bloodstained towels. I couldn't see his face, but they told me that his cheeks were very swollen and that he had blood on his nostrils here, on the nose and the mouth. The communique said, I can almost quote it, faced with the arrogance of the federal government and of its lackey Bourassa, the FLQ decided to take action. Mr. Pierre Laporte, Minister of Unemployment and Assimilation, was assassinated this evening at 18 minutes past 6 by the Dieppe cell, and in brackets, the 22nd Regiment. You will find the body in the trunk of a green Chevrolet, bearing license number 9J2420. The Front de Libération du Québec, we shall overcome. And there was some indication of where the car was parked, a sort of little sketch of the surrounding area. And a bit lower it was written, warning to all the capitalists in Quebec. And how does it go exactly? Let everyone be on his guard, or something like that. I forget the last sentence, but it goes something like this. And from now on, this is the way things are going to be. Now, this very evening, it is clear that the silent revolution is dead. I have the impression that the real revolution is beginning, that some sort of civil war is stirring in Quebec, and that something extremely serious has just happened. A lot of stupid things are going to happen from now on. People will perhaps be tempted to kill indiscriminately.
Et je souhaite au peuple canadien